America knows which way the wind is blowing. Even NASCAR is banning Confederate flags right now because people, including one of their own drivers, spoke up loud and clear. What are you going to do if someone raises a Confederate flag? What's the next action, Baba? I don't know.
That's a good question. That's why these conversations are being had right now, each and every day. I need to get a new battery for my phone. It's been going through so much. But we are trying to figure out next steps. And my next step would be to get rid of all Confederate flags.
But not this president. He's refusing to even consider renaming military bases bearing the names of Confederate military commanders, tweeting, "These monumental and very powerful bases have become part of a great American heritage and a history of winning, victory, and freedom." But they lost. They didn't win. They actually was going against what America wanted. But you want to name a military base after? You're going to fight for that? Okay. Do your thing. The president going against his own defense secretary and the secretary of the army, both open to discussing renaming the bases, bases named after Confederate military commanders. In other words, the people, listen to me, the people these bases honor by bearing their names are traitors who lost. You want to defend that? Go right ahead. Yes, many American heroes trained at those bases and fought and won battles and wars. The fight for freedom, for liberty, for America. Many, many of them black and brown. We could rename the bases after some of them. Here discussing in military analyst, retired Lieutenant General Mark Hertling and Reverend Robert W. Lee, a descendant of Robert E. Lee. He's also the author of A Sin by Any Other Name, Reckoning with Racism and the Heritage of the South. So glad to have both of you on and eager to have this conversation. General, there are 10 military bases named after Confederate leaders. Defense Secretary Esper and the Army Secretary, they were open to renaming them. How does it look that the president is nixing the idea? What do you think of this?
A couple things come to mind, Don. I think part of the driving force behind this was the fact that both the Navy and the Marine Corps banned the Confederate flags from their bases, which was a good idea. This topic of changing the names of these bases, this isn't the first time it's brought up. I remember this coming up about 10 years ago when I was still in active duty. And at the time, it was like, oh, yeah, okay, that's a small problem. Let's not think about it. But I think part of what we've seen over the last 2 weeks is the desire to have a deeper conversation about these kinds of things. And having been on all these bases, frankly, I never really thought about the history of them, even though I knew what it was until recently and how it might be offending some of our African-American soldiers.
Reverend Lee, the veneration of these Confederate leaders comes from an ideology called the Lost Cause. Explain what that is.
Well, Don, I was steeped in the Lost Cause growing up. It's this idea, even in the most progressive homes of the South, that generally the standard bearer of Southern heritage was a genteel man. He was quote unquote kind to his slaves, whatever that means. And deeper than that, it is an idea that this Confederacy fought against the United States for states' rights. What the Lost Cause fails to complete in that sentence is the states' rights to enslave people. We never learned that little last bit in school. And even deeper than that, in school we're taught it's the War of Northern Aggression, not the Civil War, as it is properly called.
Yeah, and listen, as a son of the South, I'm surprised about how many people are ignorant really of the meaning and when those statues and monuments were erected, and even the Confederate flag. They just have no idea about the real history of it. Reverend, one more question for you. Tonight, you know, almost the same time as the president tweeted in support of these Confederate names, NASCAR said it will no longer permit the display of Confederate flags at their events. What does that say about NASCAR, that NASCAR is recognizing what's happening here, but the president isn't?
Well, Don, I grew up in Statesville, North Carolina, just north of Charlotte, where the Charlotte Motor Speedway is. I'm personally not the biggest fan of NASCAR, but it kind of permeates our culture and everything we do down here. You know, I'm a pastor first, and it seems to me that it would be beneficial for this administration to act more in a pastoral capacity to our nation right now. We don't need this coming from our highest offices. We need people who are willing to unite, to care, to mend the wounds that are seeping right now. I mean, this is a painful reality for all of us. But we do have hope. We are not without hope in the sense that people like NASCAR, agencies, institutions, people are waking up. Mm-hmm. They should have woken up a long time ago. But in all actuality, now that they're waking up, they're seeing the possibility that change brings.
General Air Force Chief, Chief of Staff, General Charles Brown, becoming the first black service chief in American history after his confirmation this week. He spoke out about what he is thinking after George Floyd's killing. Listen to this.
I'm thinking about some of the insensitive comments made without awareness by others. I'm thinking about being a captain at the Oak Club with my squadron and being told by other African Americans that I wasn't black enough, since I was spending more time with my squadron than with them. I'm thinking about my mentors and how rarely I had a mentor that looked like me.
General, black Americans make up a big part of the military. Is that part of why the military would be willing to just consider this?
Don, if you look at the history of the military, they have always been out front in many elements of social change. And I think in this particular instance, on this one, we've somewhat been behind. We've done all the right programs, we've had all the right processes, but we really haven't often looked deep into our hearts and our souls. And that's what some of the conversations have been about this week, of really opening up that conversation. So General Brown's quotes, I think, are reflective of any military leader. I had one particular battalion commander that worked for me, Dana Pittard. You've had him on your show a couple of times. And he really enlightened me in many ways like this, about some of the comments that I never heard that he did. And these are the kinds of things that a white American is not understanding. And that's why what is happening right now is opening people's eyes a little bit, and I think has been a good thing in many ways.
I've got to go, General. Can you just real quick for me, please, please, please. What other country venerates defeated traitors with statues and bases named after them?
None. I lived in Germany for 12 years, Don, and I never saw a statue to Hitler or to Rommel or to Goebbels or anybody else, because they've erased that part of their history because it was so evil. We need to do the same.
Thank you both. See you soon. Be safe.